I request Mr. Manoharan to please come and deliver the keynote address. Mr. Manoharan, sir.
Respected and beloved author of the book released today, Thiru G. Chidambaram, and his illustrious son and my good friend Mr. Shivakumar, Group Captain Vijay Kumar, who has architected this program through MMA, other distinguished special invitees, members of MMA, and beloved ladies and gentlemen. I deem it a privilege to be given this opportunity to release this book, which is very thought-provoking. In fact, it is difficult to conceptualize such a topic, GDP, and present it in a very lucid manner. It's not just meant for those who are fond of economics, but even for a layman, this is bound to be very enlightening, elucidating, and more especially for the students who learn the country's path towards achieving the GDP growth, and those who want to do research on macroeconomics, microeconomics. This would provide immense, you know, fund of knowledge and information. In fact, அந்த தலைப்பை ரொம்ப அருமையாக சொல்லியிருக்கார், நாடும் வளமும் ஜிடிபி, அதாவது நேஷன் அண்ட் வெல்த் அப்படின்ற ஆங்கிளில் பார்த்தா, அண்ட் ஆஸ் ஹி வாஸ் மென்ஷனிங் ப்ரையர் டு 91 த குளோபலைசேஷன் லிபரலைசேஷன் ப்ரைவேடைசேஷன் ரெஜிம் வித் பிரைம் மினிஸ்டர் நரசிம்ம ராவ் அண்ட் ஃபைனான்ஸ் மினிஸ்டர் மன்மோகன் சிங், அண்ட் ப்ரையர் டு தட் வாட் வாஸ் த சினாரியோ, அண்ட் சப்சிக்வெண்ட் டு தட் வாட் வாஸ் த சினாரியோ. I used to, you know, recall ஒரு புது கவிதை தமிழில், those days prior to 91, the way state of economy was there, you know, somebody wrote, சுதந்திரம் இந்திய இரவிலே வாங்கினோம் இன்னும் விடியவே இல்லை. That was the gloomy kind of a scenario. Another version was, இந்தியா வளமையான நாடுதான் நானும் ஒத்துக்கொள்கிறேன். இந்தியா வளமையான நாடுதான் நானும் ஒத்துக்கொள்கிறேன், ஏனென்றால் இத்தனை பேர் கொள்ளையடித்த பிறகு இன்னும் மிச்சம் இருக்கிறதே. There is enormous amount of wealth, minerals, natural resources. That's why some economists commented, India is a rich country inhabited by poor people. And when are these people are going to become rich? That is the anguish, that is the anxiety. Thanks to the reformation that happened post 91, and India is emerging stronger and is galloping towards prosperity. And you know, I'm not a befitting person to comment on the contents of this book because of its rich knowledge and wisdom and enormous amount of experience. The way he has couched, condensed, and presented it. 10 chapters, 88 questions. And the questions have been framed in a logical sequence. In fact, I had been a teacher myself for CS students. And the good quality of a teacher is to have boundaries within which the teaching has to happen. Because if you breach the boundaries, the students will get confused. You might be imparting knowledge which is unnecessary. I found that technique being ably adopted all through this book. In fact, he says, for one question, he says, we need not browse, you know, go deeper on that. He himself cautions the readers. So, in fact, I stopped teaching because the present day youth are very, very, you know, their IQ level is phenomenally good. They may not know the subject, but they can easily find out whether the teacher knows the subject or not. So I stopped teaching. And this book, I think, will be a feast of knowledge for any kind of a student. And all of us are keen to learn. In fact, கற்றது கைமண் அளவு கைமண் அளவு கல்லாதது உலக அளவு. I realized that when I read this book. How much we presume we know about economics, but still we do not know. The concepts connected with GDP, the evolution of this concept world over, how it originated in US, how it was reformed, given shape, how India pioneered variants of implementation of the GDP, and the track historical background and the genesis of GDP, the methods of computation, and what changes happened subsequently, and the data and the lucid explanations and the examples, more importantly, the examples, and the poetical way in which he has presented it. அறிஞர் ஜான்சன் வந்து இலக்கியத்தை பற்றி ஒரு டெஃபினேஷன் கேட்குறாங்க. இலக்கியம் என்றால் என்ன என்று கேட்குறாங்க. அதுக்கு அவர் சொல்கிறாரு, கற்பனையை அறிவிற்கு துணையாக கொண்டு உண்மையை இன்பத்தோடு இணைத்து கூறும் கலை தான் இலக்கிய கலை. ஸோ யூ ஹாவ் டு ஹாவ் இமேஜினேஷன், யூ ஷுட் ஆல்சோ ஹாவ் இன்டெலிஜென்ஸ், அண்ட் யூ ஷுட் பிளெண்ட் தி இன்ஃபர்மேஷன் நாலெட்ஜ் the substance in a more interesting fashion. Unmaiye inbathodu inaitthu koorum kalai ilakkeekal. I found a book on GDP can be made so interesting, because avar sonnaru GDP la there are merits and demerits, there are positives and negatives. Adha book la eppadi solliirukkarana idhu maari sollala, ilakkiya nayathoda solraaru. குறை ஒன்றும் இல்லை மறைமூர்த்தி கண்ணான்னு இசைப்பாட முடியாது ஜிடிபியை பற்றின்னு போட்டார். இது மாதிரி தான் புத்தகம் முழுவதும் பார்த்திங்கன்னாக்கா சொல்கிறதையே ஒரு இனிமையாக நம்மளுக்கு அதை புரிகிற மாதிரி ரொம்ப அழகாக சொல்லியிருக்காரு. இந்த புத்தகத்தை வந்து when I was reading, it was really enriching and enlightening. And having come to launch this book on GDP, I'm sure the audience will be interested to know some of my views on the present state of affairs of the Indian GDP. And Group Captain Vijay Kumar was mentioning, day in and day out you find many articles and comments, observations about the way in which the economy is moving forward. What is the reason for the present slowdown, the lull, the so-called depression? Why is that in the last quarter of last financial year it dipped to 5.8%, then to 5%, and now last quarter that is 4.5%, and the rating of the year has been reduced by RBI itself in the policy statement to 5%. And the same figure is announced by the statistical ministry few days ago, 5%. And the World Bank also has come out saying it will not be 6%, it is only 5%. So it synchronizes, the slowdown is obvious. I would identify and attribute to three factors for this present state of economy. The first one is the domestic factors. The domestic factors, in terms of the multilateral reforms, multifarious reforms that are happening simultaneously all across the economy, starting from demonetization, GST, IBC, insolvency and bankruptcy code, and consolidation of banks and insurance, cleaning up of NPAs. In fact, NPAs, in my view, originated during good times, when economy was booming. There was indiscriminate borrowing and indiscriminate lending, I would say. And growth expansion beyond means. But today, is in the present scenario, it is perceived to be bad times, tough times, isn't it? Now, every rupee that is being lent today, you can be rest assured, will not become NPA. Will not become NPA, because the entrepreneurs are also doubly cautious on what to borrow, when to borrow, how much to borrow, how to deploy, all that. And bankers also have become very prudent, very cautious. In fact, bankers these days sanction your loan after you place all the evidence to prove that you are not in need of it. So, every rupee that is lent deserves to be lent. So that is the scenario. So this cleaning up is also happening. So all kinds of reforms happening simultaneously across the many sectors. It's bound to be a painful transformation. Unorganized sector migrating to organized sector. Parallel economy, the stock getting destroyed. And fresh stock finds it choking, difficult to pile up. And GST implementation indirectly helps your, not only to capture the top line because of input tax credit, but also it exposes your real bottom line and therefore calls you, demands you to pay income tax. And therefore the number of taxpayers are growing gradually. These are all painful transformations. And therefore to give, Arumiya Sonar, Indha Varsham Pandrathukku Ungalukku Udane Palan Indha Varsham Kedaikadhu. Porumaiya wait pananum. இப்போ நல்லா இருக்குன்னாக்க நாலஞ்சு வருஷத்துக்கு முன்னாடி பண்ணதனுடைய பலன் தான் அப்படின்னு அழகாக சொன்னார். ஸோ தட் இஸ் எக்ஸாக்ட்லி வாட் இஸ் ஹேப்பனிங் நவ். இட்ஸ் எக்கானமி இஸ் வார்மிங் அப், இட்ஸ் கியரிங் அப். இந்தியா வாஸ் லைக் அ நேஷனல் ரன்னர். ஹவு டு மேக் திஸ் நேஷனல் ரன்னர் டு கம்பீட் இன் இன்டர்நேஷனல் கேம்ஸ், கம்பீட் குளோபலி? தென் வி ஃபவுண்ட் தேர் ஹேட் டு பி சம் சர்ஜரி கேரிட் அவுட். Sudden new methods of training has to be done. All those happened. And when surgery happens, for a few days you have to be in ICU. Then you will come back to normal ward. I think the past economic advisor said Indian economy is in ICU. I checked up, it got discharged. It is now it's no longer in ICU, it is in normal ward now. So the growth is, it is now moving to runway. It is no longer in the bay, parking bay. It has come to the runway, taxiing around. And it is bound to gallop. And it will take off. And once this elephant, this gigantic elephant takes off, no force on this world is going to stop this. No force on this world is going to stop this. Consumption has dipped. Because consumption has dipped, demand is decreased. Because demand has decreased, supply is cautious and production is not happening. It is scaled down. If production is scaled down, layoffs happen, retrenchment happens, unemployment happens, VRS schemes are floating. 92,000 BSNL, MTNL employees are taking VRS. And even software companies are laying off people. All this is bound to happen. There is a phase when economy grows with the job growth. There was a phase when economy grew without job growth. That is less jobless growth. Now job loss growth. That is also happening. So it is bound to be painful. And once the production comes down, the investor sentiment is put at status quo, that there is no fresh investments that will come all that easily, cautiously only, they'll wait. And once that dips, then the employment, the purchase power, the saving capacity, again consumption. So it's a vicious cycle, but it is not a vicious cycle which external forces have trapped us in. We have methodically, systematically ironing out the unnecessary factors, peripheral factors, and therefore we are undergoing this phase and we are going to come out of it very soon. So that is the internal factors. External factors. You gauge across the globe, to blame India that it is slow down, show me one economy which is galloping. Every economy is struggling. Maybe we were the fastest growing economy 1 year back. But now we have allowed China and Indonesia to surpass us in terms of growth rate. Their base, of course, China base is larger, but still we are the third fastest developing economy, first developing economy. But look at the way the global economies are changing their approach and attitude. Can you believe America, which is supposed to be the most developed nation, is now talking about protectionism, localization of jobs, restricting H-1B visas, and there is a trade war between China and the US. There are sanctions against few economies. Europe is struggling with the Brexit problem. And Middle East is finding alternative resources to oil. And they are coming out with VAT implementation, all those things. So across the globe, the growth, GDP growth rate is 1%, 2%, some economies negative. Emerging markets growth rate on an average is 4.6%. And in that, 5% is reasonably good. So there is a turbulence across the global economies. But in that, India's resilience to sail through this global turbulence is obviously visible. All that we need is a little amount of patience. So that is the second, external factors. The third one is neither domestic nor external, but it is universal. That is the digital disruptions that are happening. Technology, you know, from industrial revolution, agricultural revolution to industrial revolution, it took thousands of years. From industrial revolution to technological revolution, the information technology revolution, it took hundreds of years. From information technology revolution to digital revolution, that is industry 4.0, the artificial intelligence, robotic, cloud computing, blockchain technology, all this is happening in few decades, the last few decades. So, and the pace at which it is happening, today, if somebody is losing a job, it is not because of incompetence, non-performance, or anything. It is because that job is becoming redundant. It is no longer existing. So who has, what we need to do? We need to stay relevant and adapt. Charles Darwin, what he said those days becomes most relevant now. It is not the strongest of the species that will survive, not the most intelligent, but the one who is able to adapt to the change that is happening around. And that is what, you know, the change, transformation is happening all around. So these three factors, in my view, should explain to the slowdown in the economy. And in my view, it should not be a cause of concern. It is a matter of time before we move ahead and gallop. Now let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, there are certain things that we need to do in addition to what we are doing. As a common man perception, I'm highlighting few things. First one, of course, government should invest more and spend more, both in infrastructure and other fields. And in fact, if data reveals that many of the industries or organizations are suffering on account of liquidity crunch because government departments are not paying what they have to pay to these organizations, business organizations. So those things need to be released. The refunds have to be released faster. So that will facilitate liquidity flow. Second is judicial system. We allow cases to attain adulthood before pronouncing verdict. Judicial reforms, if no doubt, ease of doing business, we were 142nd rank 5 years ago. It moved to 130 2 years later. Then it jumped to 100 next year. Then we moved to 77 in 2018. And 2019, we moved to 63rd rank. The goal is to come within the top 50. And in that, all these reforms are covered. If these reforms happen in terms of judicial, you know, expediency, because justice delayed is justice denied. No doubt justice hurried is justice buried, but there has to be a limitation if you have to compete at the global level. So from that perspective, that reform, arbitration mechanism, all those things, dispute resolution, Even IBC had teething problems because of lack of adequate benches and members, but now all that is getting sorted out. We had this SR Steel Limited, which gave a bonanza to the banks in terms of recovery of 42,000 crores, and all that is happening now. So the momentum will pick up very soon. And then in terms of per capita GDP, ஐயா அருமையாக சொன்னார், வளர்ச்சி மட்டும் வளர்ச்சி இருந்தால் போதாது, டெவலப்மெண்ட்டும் இருக்கணும், ஸோ மேம்பாடும் இருக்கணும் அப்படின்ட்டு. ஸோ க்ரோத் வர்சஸ் டெவலப்மெண்ட் அண்ட் பார்க்குறப்போ டெவலப்மெண்ட் இஸ் வெரி வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். ஃபார் தேட் த ட்ரூ யார்ட் ஸ்டிக் இஸ் இட் இஸ் நாட் யூனோ இந்தியா வாஸ் இந்தியா புஷ்ட் கனடா டு 10th position and moved to 9th position in terms of GDP nominal value basis size. Purchase power parity, of course, we are third. China is number one, US is number two, India is number three. But I don't want to go to that aggressive side, but I would prefer to stay in the conventional nominal value basis GDP. So India became 9th largest GDP on nominal value basis in 2010. In 2015, we pushed Italy and Brazil to 8th and 9th position, and we moved to 7th position. 2018, we overtook France and moved to 6th position. But again, we slipped because of these reforms. But now, again, in 2019, we overtook France and retained the 6th position. Now we are in a touching distance to UK. And before this year, and now we are 2.93 trillion size economy. Very soon we will overtake UK and become 3 trillion economy by the end of this year, 5th position. And next 5 to 6 years, we are bound to surpass Germany, which is 4.2 trillion, and Japan 5.2 trillion, and become 3rd position. And when this happens, by 2030, I think three nations will be competing with each other. I mean, amongst themselves. That is US, China, and India. That is the triangular contest we have to eagerly wait for. And my only desire, wish list, is that not only the nominal size of the GDP should grow. Honorable Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman said in few years we'll cross 5 trillion. In addition to that, my wish list is the per capita income, per capita GDP of every Indian should also go up. Because right now, if you see, while we can boast we are soon becoming 5th largest, we are nowhere comparable with the remaining 9 nations in terms of per capita GDP. The highest per capita GDP of US is $62,152 per capita GDP of America. Whereas the last but one is China, which is $10,088. And where is India? India is just $2,135. And that is why Chetan Bhagat also wrote an article in Sunday Times. Our dream should be by 2030, per capita GDP should become $5,000 of an Indian, which will be reasonably working out, even presuming the same value. His calculation is, you know, about 3,60,000 per annum, which means 30,000 per month, which will be, you know, sustainable and will make a standard of living good, living and all that. In fact, Aya sonar, adavadhu quantity mattum podadhu, quality um venum, life adu productive ah iruka unproductive asseta poda andha mari ella pesnaru adu exactly. In fact, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam enna sonnaru, GDP mattum paakkudadhu, GDH irundha nalla irukkunnaru, gross domestic happiness, makkal evlo sandoshama irukanga abindrathu oru hard stick ah irukkunnaru. In fact, namba March 20th is celebrated as World Happiness Day. Of course, it is not as popular as Valentine's Day. At the UN, every year they release a World Happiness Report. We are ranked 140th. We are ranked 140th. So we have to go a long way on many of those parameters. So for that, per capita GDP, one, it should improve. Second is human resources development index. Unfortunately, we are 130th ranked human resource development. We have immense potential for the youth. Less than 20 years of India's population is 41%. 20 years to 59 years, it is 50%. And 60 and above is only 9% of the population, which means American population is stagnating population, European, Australian is declining population, Chinese, Japanese is aging population. It is only India's population which is young population. And this young population, if only we can empower them with the skill sets that are required for the present day and the future, they will transform the economy. They will take it forward. No doubt the world is afraid of the Indian youth. 30 years ago, American parents used to tell their children at the breakfast table, children, eat well, because millions of Indian children are starving without this one meal per day. Today, the same American parents are telling their children, children, study well, otherwise millions of your jobs will be taken away by Indian children. That is the potential we have in terms of human resource talent. In fact, India, if only we can empower the youth with the skill sets, instead of demographic disaster, it can be a demographic dividend. And if that happens, India can emerge as the human resource hub for the rest of the world also. That is happening in a small way, but it has to happen in a big way. And as it happens, you know, why China was faster than India in poverty alleviation? Because they followed their GDP growth was driven more by manufacturing sector. So when you follow that manufacturing sector pattern of growth, the prosperity percolates down to the working class, the masses. But we followed service sector driven growth. In service sector, it is good, but the problem is the prosperity stagnates at the creamy layer of the society. It doesn't percolate down to the masses. It doesn't empower the working class with the purchase power. That is happening. That is why Make in India, Startup India, all these are all reforms, so that manufacturing sector will not only give direct jobs, it will also give allied jobs, ancillary jobs, and connecting with the ancillary units, so on and so forth. So it will be multifold. And when that happens, you know, today look at the imbalance in the workforce. Service sector contributes 57% of the GDP, but it is deploying only 25% of the workforce. Manufacturing sector contributes 27% of the GDP. It deploys only 22% of the workforce. Agricultural sector contributes only 16%, but it is consuming 53% of the workforce. It was more than 60%, but thanks to this Make in India, all those things, it is coming down to 53%. So this imbalance also, more and more youth getting migrated to manufacturing sector and to some extent in the emerging areas, that will happen even in the service sector. So that is another wish list. Yet another wish list is, you know, the many of these economies, when they grew, அதாவது வளரும் வளர்ந்து கொண்டிருக்கிற நாடுகளாக இருந்து வளர்ந்த நாடுகளாக மாறிய தருணத்தில், what is the price that they have paid? If you look at the Western economies, for growth and development, on the economic front, they have paid huge price in terms of destroying their culture, values, institutions, which are part of the society. I think India should stand apart and demonstrate that we can economically grow by preserving our rich tradition and culture, preserving institutions, value systems, marriage as an institution, family as an institution, respect for elders, respect for source of knowledge, teachers, all this we must preserve and grow, even if it takes a little longer than it ought to take. The next one, you know, one generation of India gave theosophy to humanity. Yet another generation built monuments. Another generation was instrumental in agricultural revolution. Another generation, industrial revolution. The last generation, information technology revolution. What should be the contribution of the present generation? I think present generation should contribute to bringing about a moral revolution, which is nothing but ensuring probity in public life. Probity in public life, if it comes, corruption does not find a place. You know, we used to say honesty, integrity should percolate down from the top. But it seems to take enormous time to percolate down to the top. And again, we have multilateral institutions, central government, state governments, divergent culture, approach, attitude. So all across, if there can be probity in public life, that will give immense confidence and faith to global investors to come to India. They will not expect that to be an entrance. So that, if it can happen, it'll be wonderful. And in fact, what we need is, what we had before 91 was politics in economics. I think now we are having economics in politics. That is a positive sign, and that is very much required. And you know, this book, I'm sure, will reach all the libraries, because it will be a very good referencer for all readers, including the students and research scholars. And in fact, ஔவையார் வந்து திருக்குறளை படிச்சுட்டு திருவள்ளுவர் பற்றி கமெண்ட் பண்ணுறப்ப இப்படி எழுதி சொல்லியிருக்காங்க. இடைக்கடார் என்றவர் என்ன சொன்னாருனாக்கா, கடுகை துளைத்து கடலை புகுத்தி சிறுக தடுத்து குறள்னு சொன்னாங்க. பட் ஔவையார் அதை இம்ப்ரூவ் பண்ணி அணுவை துளைத்து ஏழு கடலை புகுத்தி சிறுக தரித்து குறள் அப்படின்னு சொன்னாங்க. எனக்கு இதை படிக்கிறப்போ 159 பக்கத்தில் ஒரு 10 சாப்டரில் 88 கேள்விக்கு பதில் சொல்கிற அளவில் உலக பொருளாதார அந்த சரித்திரத்தையும் அந்த அறிவியலையும் இவ்வளோ அழகாக எளிமையாக எளிமைப்படுத்தி அவர் ப்ரெசென்ட் பண்ணியிருக்கிறப்போ எனக்கு அந்த ஒரு உணர்வு தான் வந்தது. அந்த ஒரு டெஃபினேஷன் தான் பொருத்தமாக இருக்கும்னு தோணுச்சு. ஸோ அந்த வகையில் ஐயாவை எவ்வளவு பாராட்டினாலும் தகும். இறுதியாக, அதாவது அமெரிக்காவில் வந்து மார்ட்டின் லூதர் கிங் வர ஐ ஹாவ் மை ட்ரீம் அப்படின்ட்டு ஒரு சொல்லியிருக்காரு. யா, ஸோ அவருடைய ட்ரீம் அப்போது அவர் சொன்னப்போ இதெல்லாம் நடக்குமா அப்படின்ற மாதிரி இருந்தது. ஏன்னா அவர் என்ன, ஐ விஷ் தி பிளாக் அண்ட் அமெரிக்கன் சில்ட்ரன் ஹோல்ட் ஹேண்ட் இன் ஹேண்ட் அண்ட் பிளே இன் த ஸ்ட்ரீட்ஸ் ஆஃப் அமெரிக்கா அப்படின்றது அவருடைய ட்ரீம். ஏன்னா ரேசிசம் வாஸ் அட் த பீக் தோஸ் டேஸ். பட் நவ் இஃப் யூ சீ, ஹிஸ் ட்ரீம்ஸ் ஹாவ் பிகம் ரியாலிட்டி பியாண்ட் ஹிஸ் ஓன் இமேஜினேஷன். நவ் யூ ஃபைண்ட் கப்புள்ஸ் பிளாக் அண்ட் ஒயிட் வெரி காமன் ஜெனரேஷன்ஸ் ஆஃப்டர். அண்ட் அமெரிக்கன் பார்ன் ஆப்பிரிக்கன் குட் பிகம் பிரசிடென்ட் ஆஃப் அமெரிக்கா. யூனோ, பியாண்ட் ஹிஸ் எக்ஸ்பெக்டேஷன் இட் டிரான்ஸ்லேட்டட் இன் டு ரியாலிட்டி ஹிஸ் ட்ரீம். So I have a dream. I'm not a Martin Luther King. I'm just an ordinary citizen of India. But I strongly believe every citizen of India is entitled to have his own dream for the nation. It doesn't matter when it will happen. I tell my students who write CA exams, which is supposed to be tough, have perseverance. Be focused and put your heart and soul. Success may not come the way you want it, when you want it. But definitely it will come one day, and when it comes, it will be much better than what you wanted. The same approach, if every citizen of India has, I think my dreams are twofold. One is, when in beyond 2030, when we compete with the US and China as the tri-party contest, and we gallop towards, you know, competing with them in every sphere, I think our currency should also become stronger and stronger and move towards becoming $1 should be equal to 1 rupee. That should be the ultimate realization. And when that happens, and by the time that happens, I'm sure, you know, all of us see day in and day out in near Anna flyover, outside American consulate, Indians standing day and night for visa. In America, outside Indian embassy, Americans should stand to get visa for visiting India. That is my humble dream. And இந்த வாய்ப்பை, அரிய வாய்ப்பை கொடுத்த ஐயா அவர்களுக்கும், திரு சிவகுமார், திரு குரூப் கேப்டன் விஜயகுமார் அவர்களுக்கும் மனமாற நன்றி பாராட்டி, இறுதியாக 18th and 19th century belong to Europe, 20th century belong to US, 21st century must belong to India என்று சொல்லி வாய்ப்புக்கு நன்றி பாராட்டி.
Thank you, sir. Thought-provoking thing, the time where we keep thinking slow down, economy, but your sharing of wisdom is really inspired us. I think we are going to be there. Still, to pause the time, we take only two or three questions. If any question, you can tell him, and you can pass on the mic, you can give the mic.
Sir, I am Professor Venkateshwaran from Laila. You have made a beautiful presentation. My query is that this government has been taking away the huge resource from Reserve Bank. They are cutting down, yesterday newspaper says, they are cutting down 2 lakhs crore worth of expenditure. Fiscal deficit is galloping. Inflation is also going up. In spite of that, slowdown is there. What could be the panacea for such a situation according to you?
See, each one of the bullet points you mentioned, like for example, Reserve Bank paying out of the reserve, surplus reserve, so much to the central government. See, globally the practice that is followed is studied, and there are nations where this practice is prevalent, where central bank of the country beyond a particular point, level of reserves should not be, you know, retained. It should be paid out to the government, which in fact is recycled by the government as capital infusion for the same sector, banking sector, because enormous amount of funds are getting reinfused, deployed. So if we should not be concerned about the policy change, because so long as it is replicated based on the experience drawn from other countries, which is true in this case, what we should be concerned is how effectively these funds are deployed. So that should be Ayasonadamari and the vigilance, the alertness. On those areas, we should be able to question if there is any abuse or misuse of these funds. And similarly, I do not think it is bad for an economy in a present scenario like this to have deficit financing. In every budget of an economy which has become a developed economy, if you look back at such critical junctures, deficit financing, deficit budgeting is bound to be there. Financial deficit is bound to go up a little, and that is only is giving the urge to step in and bridge that gap by propelling the growth and all that. Curtailing expenditure, if it is for austerity measures, it is most welcome. If it is reflected in minister spending, attending, traveling, unproductive functions, all those things, that kind of a curtailing of expenditure is most welcome, but not in terms of investment and spending for these schemes and other measures which will flow down and enhance the liquidity in the system. So we'll have to go deeper into each of these items before drawing a firm conclusion. Yeah. Per se, they are not bad.
Last question,
please. I don't have a question, but I'm a doctor, and I had the privilege of getting the book from my uncle, the author Chidambaram. So when I got the book, I saw it's written in Tamil. It's about economics. Now I have to read it because my uncle wrote it. But the power of the book, Puthavar Sakti and Nana, when I took the book, I had to finish the same day. So I also read 159 pages, 88 questions, done in a Socratic style, logical and Socratic style, and where I could not put the book down until I finished it. And the next day I called him and said, I finished the book. And today, if you want to check, being a teacher, quiz me, I can pass the exam. But if you wanted me to get a distinction, I need to brush it up again for a few minutes so I can get a distinction. In addition to what Professor Sri Manoharan said, I have the same feeling of all that he said. Two other dimensions. One is how you can weave 1,000 years of Puraladhara Varalaru, the history of economics, starting from the William the Conqueror and weaving it to the Doomsday Book that William the Conqueror invented, and to this day, how it is modified. And he is polemical throughout the book and said, we also have 1,000-year history. Rajaraja Chola must have done it. but we never documented all these things. So that is where we are lacking in terms of what, that is the power of the book. And he weaves it within 159 pages, 1,000 years of history of economics. But also within that, it's like a orchestra where you have the baritone singing the low notes. At any given point, there is a somebody who's singing the high notes. So he'll go to the high note, bring you back, and said, we will stop here, we'll do it in the later stage, he'll bring it up again. So that is another dimension. The last part is, somebody who's a doctor, and you are a finance person, my wife is an economist, she doesn't read Tamil though, and I had to give a summary to her. For me, this not only touches in terms of healthcare what I should be looking at, and contrary to Mr. Manoharan's positive views, the author leaves skeptical and a realistic rhetoric ending, saying that exactly we are in the top 9 in terms of GDP, but we are in 130 in terms of the development index. As you well know, there's one country last year who stopped measuring GDP, New Zealand, last year. They said they will stop measuring GDP because it doesn't look at the happiness. Not unlike King of Bhutan, who my uncle also mentioned in the book, who focused on gross national happiness rather than GDP 30 years ago. And New Zealand, as last year Ahern, Prime Minister Ahern, said we are not going to measure GDP. The book ends with a prescient note, saying that what you should look into. Don't look at GDP alone as a yardstick, which is well mentioned, but it's only one yardstick, but there are better yardsticks, and now we know that it's gross national happiness and genuine progress indicator. GPI is one other thing, how we are going to measure, how our output should be. And that's why we are very high in the GDP, skeptical that why we are in 130. In healthcare is the same thing. In healthcare, we could, you look at the index, Indians get the best healthcare in the world if you are in the right place and the right economic strata. But we are also the worst healthcare. There is a published, around the same time that this was published, India is only 6th from the bottom in terms of preventable deaths in the country. We are only 6th from the bottom. I mean, we are on the 180 level. So we have a big divide that we need to bridge. And I think we need to do a lot more work. And this book leaves us. So the book also stratifies the work. It could be a common man like me who doesn't know economics, get very want to do more work. So it can lead me to the research. It'll be a Bible for the undergraduate student who wants to do economics. It also gives you all the stimulus for the research for the postgraduate in economics thing. So this is a wonderful book. And I congratulate you, not because you're my, I'm congratulating you as a critique in mentioning this.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Now, one last question. I think we are closer. It's our time. We already one question. This question is reserved for international person who is watching this live from USA. His question to you, Mr. Chidambaram, is this, he wants to know what inspired you to write this book. And this question is from, yes, this question is from Vikram from USA.
I have a unique advantage which perhaps you all don't know. I am in the 7th stage of life. As you like it in Shakespeare, in the last stage, 7th stage, sans eyes, sans teeth, sans everything. I can read, think, write, but I can't hear. I don't know what is the question, and if you can.
The question is, what has come by WhatsApp to me?
Ah, very good.
Yes. What inspired you to write this book?
What inspires you? Inspires you to write.
It's from Vikram from USA. Vikram from USA.
Vikram. Vikram has asked.
You're watching this live.
Vikram is in the audience. No.
He is watching from USA.
A very interesting question from a very interesting person. The person is my own grandson. Yesterday is the question all the way from New York in America. Probably he didn't hear my speech fully. The question is, what inspired you to write this topic? As I said, the inspiration was that the Tamil-knowing people should not be in a disadvantageous position in understanding and deciding about the worth of what the government does and what the government does not do. And what the government does and what the government does not do has got very much to do with the economics. In fact, every act of, most of the acts of the government, whether it's a law or act, they have got a direct or indirect relationship to economic issues. Economic issues are dominant today. No doubt, presently it is being distracted by certain other socio-political issues, but basically economic. And therefore, my desire was that I should share my views with my Tamil brethren who have been at a disadvantage, not knowing the nuances of basics of economics. And they are at a disadvantage, and they are in majority. And therefore, I wanted to write in pure, simple Tamil that I know of, all the nuances, all the basics of economics. That's all I have done.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Gentlemen, I think Vikram, you are happy with the answer. I think it's an inspiration for each one of us to do something different. And ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause to two great leaders who share the insight. Now may I request Shivakumar and also Mr. Dr. Rajaram to come on the stage, present a memento on behalf of NMS. Dr. Rajaram. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Now I request Shivakumar, a member of a managing committee and also is a thought leader, strategic thinker, great entrepreneur and director of Root Industries Limited, director of a number of other companies, to deliver the formal vote of thanks. Before that, Mr. Swaminathan want to come and do the honor of shawl. All that honor want to do, you keep doing it, he will also deliver the vote of thanks.
One minute. We'll finish this. I'll finish. Dignitaries on the dais, the chairman, Canara Bank, Mr. T.N. Manohar, sir. He's a Padma Shri awardee. My father, Mr. G. Chidambaram, an author of this book. Ladies and gentlemen, members of MMA, friends, relatives, the media. On the right side, I have group captain. On the left side, I have major and captain. So that the hall is filled with sportsmen, doctors, no politician here perhaps, but then a huge lot of well-wishers. Firstly, I need to thank my dear friend, Sri T.N. Manoharan, a Padma Shri awardee. He is known for his honesty, his humility, and passion for excellence. Whatever he does, whenever he speaks, there's a quality of excellence in every minute that he spends. He has not only been a great strategic thinker, but actually stolen a number of hearts of youngsters in terms of making them pass their CA inter or CA final. Thank you, sir. I know there is a very, very big fan following across in towns, across in villages, across in many cities. And one of my wish is that I take you to Tanjore, where you're very, very popular. You've already told me a lot of stories about what you've done in Tanjore. One of these days, if you can visit that town and actually address a lot of students, it can be beneficial. First, let me thank you, sir, for accepting to be here on the 9th of January. We had initially thought about the 19th or the 20th, then the dates were not available. He canceled another program to be available for the MMA program and for the book launch. So I know how difficult it was and how difficult it was for you to accommodate this. Thank you for giving a very good picture of what India is going to achieve in the next 10 years. We are all going back very happy, hoping that many of the things that you spoke are going to happen. And one of those days, when the queue near the Gemini is going to reduce, when the dollar is going to be a rupee. I'm happy because the 160 rupees book will become $160, and therefore my father's dream of getting rich will be much easier. We started this program at 6 o'clock because that's what we want to reach in GDP this year, and we're ending it at 7.5. Maybe next year it'll be 7.5. So the timing is also apt in terms of GDP, where we are and where we're going to progress. And I need to touch upon one or two points about my dad. He reads about 9 or 10 hours a day. Reads or writes 9 or 10 hours a day, even till today. Every word that is published in the book was handwritten by him in a fountain pen. When he started writing this book, I thought that is just for a hobby that he's writing. One day he said, I'll publish. And I thought it's again a joke. But then I found there's something called dare and dream, or dream and dare. And that's my dad. Dare and dream, or dream and dare. He dreamt, he dared to come out with a book, made sure that it's published. He showed it to me. And then I thought we should launch it with great people like you. Thanks for making it happen. And group captain for making this program so lively. It's been at least a 50-60 calls, a few mails, a few WhatsApp messages, and a few messages. But the event has come out so well. Thanks very much, group captain. And the media who are here, I'm sure that many of this are going to be covered in tomorrow's paper or a little later. For all of you who've been here, we're fortunate that you're here and you're going to carry it in the press. And the publishers, Emerald Publishers, deserve a word of praise. And finally, a little bit about the eloquent speech given by Dr. Ravi Kumar. He should have been proposing the vote of thanks. He has read the book from page 1 to page 180 or whatever it is. Let me tell you, I started reading one or two pages, slept for a few days. Okay, so thanks so much for being part of the family and talking about every word that's written in the book. He's a great oncologist. He's in the top few doctors in the world. A very simple person. He's been in the Harvard, he's been in the Yale. He's run tremendous progress in healthcare. And now he is the chairman at AIIMS in Andhra Pradesh. So thank you so much. Be part of MMA. And if you want to improve your gross happiness, please be part of MMA. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Nice to have you with us. Bye-bye. Good night till we meet again. Get back home safely. Bye-bye.